You've seen an introduction to hybrid solutions for SQL Server. In this video, you'll dive deeper into the architectures of what's possible for disaster recovery this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined once again by Allan Hirt. Thanks for joining us again.
Thanks, Anna. Nice to be back.
And today we're going to continue our discussion about hybrid solutions for SQL Server. In the previous video, Allan talked about, you know, why you might want to do this and some of the key things you need to be aware of if you're going to do something like this. And in this video, we're going to dive a little bit deeper into what those options actually are. So with that, I'll kind of pass it over to you, Allan.
Thanks, Anna. And so in this one, I'm going to focus sort of more specifically on disaster recovery, because that's sort of, as I said in the previous video, the number one thing that I see. And really, that's honestly the thing most of you guys who are looking at this video are probably going to be looking at this for first, you know. So with that said, let's kind of dive right in. As I mentioned in the last video, backup and restore is a key sort of availability scenario for SQL Server, and I talked about how you could use it for generating backups directly up to Azure, testing them. So I'm not going to really spend any time in this particular presentation talking about that here. You can refer back to that. But what I want to focus on are if you're on premises and you want to have Azure as a DR data center, if you will, what could you set up? And there are really three main options that we're looking at here. Log shipping, and I'll explain what that is, an always-on availability group, otherwise known as an AG. It's not AOAG or always-on or AAG or anything like that. It's just AG. And always-on failover cluster instances, or FCIs. And let's talk first here about log shipping. Most of you know what this is, right? But I just want to kind of reiterate, because we have to look at it just slightly different. So location A could be your on-premises. Location B could be an Azure region, okay? And simply put, you take a full backup of your SQL Server database, you copy it to what will be the secondary server, you restore the full backup with no recovery. I need to stress that. Then you generate transaction log backup. It gets copied over to the secondary, gets restored with no recovery, and that process just repeats ad infinitum until you either stop it or, you know, something happens, right? Now, this has been around forever. It was first in the product in SQL Server 7. It was in Enterprise Edition then. It was in all editions from SQL Server 2000 on. Even if Microsoft ripped this feature out of SQL Server today, you could implement this on your own, because it's just backup, copy, and restore. There are any number of ways to slice and dice this one. Now, the nice thing about this one is this is very tolerant of things like networking. So as long as you don't have massive T-log backups, you could do this, you know, all the time, and probably nobody's going to break a sweat. And the fact is, people have been doing this for 20, 25 years now. So it's a known quantity. This is just easy to set up, easy to maintain. There's not a lot involved to admin this. And quite frankly, it just works. Now, you do have to worry about logins and jobs and things that sit outside the database. And we're not going to delve into all that in this presentation. But just know that this is an option, and you don't have to do anything fancy to have DR, right? Even if you're just putting your backups there, up in Azure, that's one thing. This is another, and this is sort of the next easy step from that, right? Now, going on to something a little more modern than something that we've had in the product since SQL Server 7, let's talk about AGs, which have been in the product since SQL Server 2012. Now, up until SQL Server 2016, and the thing I'm going to talk about on the next slide, this is how everything had to look. So underneath your availability group, you have a cluster. Now, the cluster would either be a Windows Server failover cluster, also known as a WSFC, or pacemaker if you're using Linux. And you would extend that cluster from on-premises up to Azure. That means things like your witness or how you're doing the similar concept called Stoneth in pacemaker. That has to all work because now you're bridging two different locations. And that's a bigger talk than I kind of want to get into in just introducing the concept here. So just know that that's important. But with an availability group, and in this traditional way of deploying it, it's a monolithic view of the world, meaning it's one availability group, one cluster stretched across two locations. So here what we have is we've got the primary replica, which is this P right here, and we've got a few secondary replicas. So just so we're clear, this scenario that I'm showing here would be Enterprise Edition. If you have Standard Edition, you can only have two total replicas, one primary, one secondary. So imagine, for example, that this one and this one didn't exist if you're running Standard. But having said that, what that also means is that if you have network issues between Azure and on-premises, or any problems in connectivity, and like let's say the primary can't send up to Azure, the primary is going to hold on to those transactions until it can do that, meaning your T-log is going to grow. So having reliable networking, which we talked about a lot in the last video, really starts to come into play here. Log shipping is much more tolerant of things like that because you're backing up the T-log, right? And it's getting flushed. Here, things are going to stick around until, you know, it's able to flush things out. The other thing about this is, from a management point of view, while it's monolithic and simpler on that level, getting everything right so that things don't blip or things just flow is a lot harder because you're managing one thing across two different locations. Now, I do have customers who do this. This is nothing new. Again, this was in the product and the way you had to deploy this, starting with SQL Server 2012. Just making you aware that this works, but maybe there's a better option. And we'll look at that here in the next slide. Let's talk about distributed availability groups. Distributed AGs were introduced in SQL Server 2016. Unfortunately, it's an Enterprise Edition only feature. So for those of you running Standard, I'm really sorry. I have to say this is probably one of my favorite features that Microsoft has done. At the same time, it's also one of my most frustrating because right now, as of the time of recording this video, so if you're watching this in the future, maybe this will have changed, you can only deploy this via T-SQL. And all the monitoring and everything is just looking at the SQL Server Dynamic Management Views, or DMVs. So the management of this is inherently a little bit more difficult from a SQL Server standpoint and deployment, because you're talking about no GUI if that's what you like to do. However, let me explain the architecture and why I really like this. So just a quick refresher, monolithic, one thing feeds everything. Well, in a distributed AG, which is purely a SQL Server concept, you won't see this in any cluster mechanism. So if I'm on premises at location A and I want to go to location B, I'm setting up two distinctly different clusters, each with their own availability group. Now, notice that each of these has a primary, and you're going, well, how does that work? Well, this primary here is known as the global primary. This one here is known as a forwarder. So what happens is the global primary sends things to both its own secondary replicas, as well as the global, the forwarder, not the global. That is not global, that is local. Then that synchronizes everything on its end. So the advantages here, obviously, you're not worried about sort of one of the things I talked about earlier, which was, if I want to stretch my cluster, how do I do that effectively across two locations? Here, you're just dealing with them locally. Now, I can tell you from my experience, I've used this to migrate to Azure more than once, and it works. Also, I've also done it on premises, but this is nice and elegant. The other nice thing about distributed availability groups compared to a lot of other features is that you can flip the script, meaning if I flipped up to Azure, let's say, during a migration, and I needed to go back to on-premises at some point, like, we wanted to make sure everything was okay in Azure, well, the good thing is you can do that, you know, and then at some point, if when you decide that everything's good, you could just cut the distributed AG back down to on-premises. But the really nice thing here is that it enables that type of scenario. I have customers doing this for testing DR, so every couple months, like if you wanted to flip from on-premises to Azure, you could do that and flip back. It's just pretty elegant when it's all working, but understand that from a SQL Server perspective, not a cluster perspective, this is a little bit more complex that way. They're both great architectures. You just have to really think about maybe what's the best one for you. All right, last but certainly not least, I'm going to talk about something that I've been using now for well over 20 years, and that's FCIs. Now, FCIs, near and dear to my heart, but I will tell you, not my preferred method for any kind of DR because they're inherently more difficult to set up and they're a bit different than AGs. Let me explain. So FCIs require a cluster, and they are supported in both Linux and Windows, which is good. But the biggest difference between this and an availability group is that FCIs always required some form of shared storage when this becomes sort of the rub, because that shared storage becomes a single point of failure locally, which is why we usually use like an availability group or log shipping or something else to make it extra available so that storage isn't a single point of failure. Now, how they work is that an FCI is running on this server, also called the node of the cluster, and its resources, and in particular here we're talking about the storage, is owned by this node, if you will. That's why this has a dotted line here, is that the storage associated with this FCI isn't seen by this server until the FCI fails over, and then this one will become the solid one, and then this will become the dotted line. Fairly straightforward. Again, most of you who are watching this video probably have implemented one or seen one somewhere along the way. The problem is, when we're talking about DR, unlike an AG, or unlike a distributed AG, which is purely a SQL Server method, to achieve disaster recovery, you've got to somehow get your storage replicated somewhere else. And in this case, we're talking, say, location B or Azure. Unfortunately, most hardware storage vendors don't have a direct connect to Azure, so that would be out. You can set up storage replica in Windows Server failover clusters, but you have to do that at setup time, so at least that's how it works today. So that could be a potential issue, and there might be other go, no-go type of things that go along with storage replica. You can use a third-party program, and the one that's most common is Sios Data Keeper. That one has been around for a while, but again, it's sort of, you need to figure that out a bit ahead of time and get that done when you install. So this isn't something I completely am on board with unless you've thought this out ahead of time. Now, can you get it working? Absolutely. The other thing you need to figure out, which we're out of scope for today's little video here, is what shared storage options are even available in Azure. That's a whole different thing. Now, the other thing that you want to think about here, and it's largely true with availability groups as well, and it's why I sort of had four there, is that if you failed over here, you probably just don't want a single node FCI up in Azure, right? So you're probably going to want something like this. Now, just like that initial availability group picture, notice this is a monolithic view of the world, right? The only one that doesn't give you a real monolithic view of the world is a distributed AG. Log shipping is a little bit disconnected, and it's more manageable that way, but in terms of anything that's using a cluster underneath, distributed AGs are the only things to really separate out different clusters. There are different features in Windows Server failover clusters that in theory could give you this, but they're not supported by SQL Server, so that's why I'm not talking about them. Well, as I presented there in the slides, there's a lot to digest, and I hope maybe you have to go back and rewatch a few things. I threw a lot at you there. But that is the hybrid disaster recovery story for SQL Server, you know, going up to Azure and specifically talking about having IaaS VMs up in the cloud, you know, that you would be talking to. So it's, you can still use everything you use on premises today. And if you, honestly, if you just want to think about it, as I said in the last video, it's just an extension of your data center. You'd be doing a lot of the same things if you're going to a physical data center. But in this case, we're just talking about Azure.
Awesome. Thanks, Allan. This was really interesting. Personally, I don't have years and years of SQL Server experience, so I learned a lot in this video, and I think probably our viewers did as well. I also learned about these availability options that are kind of built in our PaaS services, how there is some extra effort that actually goes into setting them up, and I'm sure you have lots of stories, good and bad, about your experiences with those. Now, if you liked this video as a viewer, please like our video and subscribe to our channel. Again, thanks so much, Allan, for being here, and we'll see you next time on Data Exposed.